you must have had examinations this week, right? Studying for examinations.
It's an undergraduate. Right?
It's an undergraduate.
Yeah.
Oh, that's, that's even worse. Even worse. Okay. Okay. So everything so far has been in the context of projected equations. Now we're going to discuss a different approach that seems to be fundamentally unrelated, aggregation. However, we will see that it's also connected with the projection equation approach. In aggregation, the major idea is to approximate either the optimal cost function or the cost function associated with policies with a cost-to-goal function of a simpler problem. So we have a complicated problem. We will try to look at a simpler version of this problem and solve that in place of the original. And the approach is aggregation, and the main elements are we introduce a few aggregate states which are viewed as the states of an aggregate system. Our objective is to formulate an aggregate problem involving just a few states. To do this, we need to define transition probabilities and cost functions for this aggregate system. And in order to make the aggregate problem related to the original, the transition probabilities and costs have to be related to the transition probabilities and costs of the original problem. And we have to relate original system states with aggregate states. After we do that, we solve exactly or approximately the aggregate problem by any kind of value iteration of policy iteration, perhaps even with simulation-based methods, to obtain approximations of J star and J mu. And let's say that aggregate state Y has an optimal cost or cost of policy R hat Y. So this is a number associated with aggregate state Y, and there are several of those Ys. We use the cost function approximation, which is a weighted sum of these R hats. Okay. So we have a big state space, states J in it, and we solve the aggregate problem, a different problem that involves these few but sort of bigger states. We get the cost of those states, and then we use a weighted sum of this cost of the approximate of the aggregate problem to approximate the optimal cost of the original problem. Now, what are these weights here? First of all, they are probabilities. They add up to one, okay? And we call them the aggregation probabilities. And basically, they encode the degree of membership of J into the aggregate state Y. It's how J relates to Y, in some sense, that this phi here encodes. Now notice that you can also view these phi terms as features, okay? Basically, this is of the form phi R, capital R. So there's a matrix phi here of the aggregation probabilities weighted by a vector of R hats, a smaller dimensional version of R hats. So this is a linear architecture with the phi JY are the features of state J. One feature for aggregate state 1, one figure for aggregate state 2, and so on. So at a higher level, we're not doing anything different. It is, again, a linear feature-based architecture, but the training method is different because now we're looking at a simplified problem to get these coefficients. So now let's look at an example and see how we can get this aggregate problem, how we can define it. The simplest example is hard aggregation. In hard aggregation, we have this big original system, and we group various states of the system together. As an example, let's say we have 9 states of the original system. We group these 4 together into a single aggregate state. Here we group 2, here 1, 2, and so on. So we have 9 original system states and 4 aggregate states. And the aggregation probabilities in hard aggregation is what you see here. For state 1, these are the aggregation probabilities. State 1 is going to be related to the aggregate cost of aggregate state 1, exactly, and so on. So if I solve the aggregate problem, somehow I define this aggregate problem, I get 4 numbers, okay? The cost of aggregate state 1, cost aggregate state 2, 3, and 4. And my original system cost function is a piecewise constant function where all the states in here have the same cost, the aggregate cost of the state. All the states in here, the 2 states, have the aggregate of the state here, and so on. And this is what this phi matrix implies. The features are lined up like this. The columns are the basis functions. So after I solve the aggregate problem, that's the way I'm going to recover approximations to the cost of the original problem. However, how do I define this aggregate problem? In particular, I have to define transition probabilities from x1 to x2 to x4 and to x3. What makes sense here? Well, to define such transition probabilities, basically we have to relate them to the transition probabilities between these states and these states. Sort of some kind of an aggregate probability. And the way to do that, so that's the question. What should be the aggregate transition probabilities of x? We may select at random some state here, look at how it transitions, whether it transitions within the same aggregate state or whether it transitions out of that aggregate state, and view this state, single state, as representative of the aggregate state, and define transition probabilities that way. But which state should I use? Okay? The simplest probability is to randomize and to say I'm going to select when I am in aggregate state x1, I'm going to take by at random any one state of these states here, look at the transition probabilities, and consider the corresponding provide a probabilistic way describing how from this state I'll go back into this state or that state. So the simplest probability is to assume that all the states within the aggregate state x are equally likely. However, I can consider a more general randomization whereby I use disaggregation probabilities for aggregate state x. Dxi is a probability by which I select I within here to define the transition probability mechanism to other aggregate states. Roughly speaking, dxi is the degree to which I is representative of x. Okay? If there was a dominant state in here, I'd like to use that state more. More generally, if there are more states that are equal, that are important, I want to give positive probabilities to those as well. So if I have this dxi's, I solve the problem of transition probabilities between x1 and x2, randomize within here, consider the transition probability from any one of those, and see what part of the transition probability takes me to states in the aggregate state 2. Intuitively, that makes sense for hard aggregation, and it is this mechanism that we're going to generalize. So here's the general framework for aggregation. The original system is described by states I and j with transition probabilities pij that depend on control. We introduce these aggregate states. We want to define the transition mechanism from x to y. We introduce now these two probability types, the disaggregation probabilities defined by a matrix D with elements dxi, and the disaggregation probabilities, which are defined by this matrix phi. And the matrices D and phi are arbitrary, except for the fact that their rows have to be transition probabilities. These are the aggregation probabilities, and the meaning of phi j y is the degree of membership of j within the aggregate state y. So if j sort of relates to more than one aggregate state, then I will have more than one non-zero probabilities phi. In hard aggregation, only one phi is a one and all the others are zero. More generally, however, you could have a phi matrix involving a different kind of choice. Now, the disaggregation probability, given that we are at state x, it randomizes within this set of states I, according to these probabilities, selects the state this way in here, and then jumps off to j, and then down to y. And the meaning, intuitive meaning of the disaggregation probability is the degree to which I is representative of x. So once I give you these two matrices, D and phi, you have an aggregation scheme. Different choices of D and phi give you different types of aggregation schemes, but the theory of all those is quite common. Okay, now suppose I have given you the disaggregation probabilities and the aggregation probabilities. You can define the transition probabilities between x and y. The transition probability from x to y is obtained as the product of the probabilities of going to I, then pij to go to j, and then down to y according to this probability. So that's the transition probability, and it's well defined. It's a transition probability matrix. In fact, it is given by, it's given by this expression, and in matrix form, it's given like so. The matrix D multiplies the matrix P of the original system and multiplies the matrix phi of the disaggregation matrix phi, and that's the compact form of the transition probability matrix of the aggregate problem, and it depends on you because these Pijs depend on you. This process of going like this defines also costs. The cost of using control U at aggregate state x is obtained by randomization to go into here, then cost giu of j to go from here to here, and then that's that. That's the cost that you incur with a transition out of x. So the expected transition cost is this. And in matrix form, it is D times P, actually piece of U here, times G, G being the cost of the one stage cost, so the vector of one stage cost. So if you have a fixed policy for the aggregate problem, you can set up Bellman's equation for it, involving this and that. And you can also consider the optimal cost of the aggregate problem, which involves the corresponding operator T. Here's Bellman's equation for the aggregate problem. It is the unique solution R hat of this equation, which involves G hat, the one stage cost of the aggregate problem, and the transition probabilities of the aggregate problem. This R hat is a vector with one entry per aggregate state, ordinarily a small dimensional vector if the number of aggregate states is small. Suppose that I solve this equation and I solve the aggregate problem for the optimal costs, then I can get an approximation of the optimal cost of the original by using these phi as features, and these r's are as weights. There's also a Bellman equation associated with a policy. It's linear. If you can solve it, then you obtain an approximation to the cost of a policy by, again, a linear combination of the cost of the corresponding policy in the aggregate problem. Okay. So this is, in principle, the idea. Simplify the problem. Define the data of the problem based on the data of the original problem. Solve it. Solve the simpler problem. And then obtain an approximation to the cost of the original problem by means of a linear combination. Now let's go back and look at various special cases. We noted the case of hard aggregation earlier. And here we group the original system states into subsets, view each subset as an aggregate state. This partition is exhaustive. It covers all the states. Each state has to belong to one and only one aggregate state. The aggregation probabilities are either ones or zeros, depending on the membership of original system states into aggregate states. Again, the same figure I had before. Now, for disaggregation probabilities, there are many possibilities. For example, all the states within an aggregate state have an equal probability. So if there are, let's say, m states within an aggregate state, this probability would be 1 over m. In this particular case, it would be 1 over 4. 1 half, 1, 1 half. However, I may use more general probabilities as long as they are positive only within the corresponding aggregate states. Okay. Now I noted earlier that because of the nature of this phi matrix, what you get in the end is a piecewise constant approximation over the aggregate states. So there's a single value, of course, associated with all the states within here, all the states within here, all the states within here. It's a piecewise constant approximation. And in particular, if the optimal cost vector of the original problem is piecewise constant over the aggregate states, then hard aggregation is exact. Okay, there's no approximation error. And this suggests how I should be grouping states into aggregate states. Similar states with similar costs should go together, okay, should be grouped together. If I have some insight about what are similar states, I would be able to group them together into aggregate states. There's also a variant of this scheme called soft aggregation, where the phi entries within this matrix are not all of them one or zero. But for states that are sort of at the boundary between two aggregate states, it may involve a randomization between the aggregate states and the boundary. So for example, for state 5, this may involve a 1/2, 1/2 here. Okay? Or there may be no other entries here, non-zero entries in place of the zeros. This is called soft aggregation. Provides soft boundaries between the aggregate states. And it's something that has been used. And I'm just mentioning it just to give you an idea of the variety of possibilities. So that's hard aggregation. Each state belonging to an aggregate state. But there's the question of how do I pick the boundaries of these states? I should be grouping states with similar cost into aggregates, but how do I decide that states have similar cost? Well, I may have good features of the states, and therefore I may make the supposition that states with similar features have similar costs and should be grouped together. This is called feature-based aggregation. So the question is, how do we group states together into aggregate states? So if we know good features, then it makes sense to group together states that have similar features. Now this involves a partition that's based on the space, that's based on a partition of the space of features. From states, I get features by a feature extraction mapping. Suppose that I discretize the space of feature more or less evenly, and then I consider a partition of the state space according to which states map into which feature. So instead of bothering to discretize this space here, I discretize this space here that may be more convenient. Each one of these boxes within the feature space may be mapped into a unique aggregate state, and that induces a partition of the set of original states. Sort of an idea that has been used many times. It's an idea that makes sense if you have good features. So it's a general approach for passing from a feature-based state representation to a hard aggregation-based representation. And essentially, we discretize the space of features, and we generate, and the aggregate problem involves piecewise constant approximation within each one of these boxes. States that have similar features and are grouped together obtain the same cost, and in the end, I have a piecewise constant approximation. We discussed earlier linear feature-based approximations. Given a set of features for a state, weigh them linearly with a weight vector. This is not linear. This is piecewise constant approximation. So it's non-linear. It's a much more powerful architecture potentially than a linear architecture because it is non-linear in the features, but also it may require a lot of discretization here and a lot of aggregate states to reach the same level of performance as the level of performance of linear feature-based architectures. It's a different way to use features in approximation. This is still a hard aggregation method because every state participates into some aggregate state. Now let's look at something different, which also has a long tradition. Okay, here's the original state space. In fact, it could be continuous. It has many, many states. I look at a small subset of states, which I call representative. These black circles are representative states, and I associate with each one of these states an aggregate state. The disaggregation probabilities are 1 or 0 for the state, the original system state that happens to be also a representative. It is 1, and all the others are 0. So here, that's the disaggregation probabilities are very simply defined. The aggregation probabilities, which correspond to states that are not representative, involve some kind of randomization to the representative states. So for every state of the original system, there are these probabilities that relate them to the representative states. So for example, you might have a grid discretization of the original space, and for points that fall outside the grid, you have a probabilistic mechanism to assign them to states in the grid. The aggregate system works as follows. You start at some representative state. You generate another state, J, according to these green arrows, according to the transition probabilities of the original system. And then you go back to the representative states by means of this red probabilistic mechanism. So in the end, you go from representative state to representative state according to this probabilistic mechanism, and that defines the aggregate problem. This is what's used when you discretize a continuous state space. That's a general way to discretize a continuous state space. You generate a grid and then a mechanism of passing from the grid to the non-grid bigger space. It's very well suited for discrete Euclidean space discretization, as in control problems, for example. Also, a substantial area of application is for POMDP. I don't know if you've heard the term POMDP. POMDP. But POMDP starts for partially observable Markov decision problems. In partially observable Markov decision problems, you do not have exact knowledge of the state. The controller does not observe the state itself, but rather receives measurements about the possible whereabouts of the state and formulates a belief state, which is a probability distribution of the different states of the problem. So, from one belief state, I receive a measurement, and I move to another belief state that depends on that measurement, and this defines a Markov decision problem on the space of beliefs, a higher dimensional space, a continuous state space, because beliefs live into the unit simplex. Okay? So, to solve this POMDP type problem, you have this unit simplex, you introduce a discretization of the simplex, and you define an aggregate transition probability mechanism that involves just the discrete subset of beliefs. Formulate the corresponding Markov decision problem that involves just a finite state Markov chain, solve that in any way you want, even approximately, and that gives you, by means of this formula, gives you an approximation to the solution of the POMDP, which is piecewise linear according to this probabilistic mechanism. I don't want to get into this, but this is typically the kind of discretization you would use for continuous type of state space. Okay, now here's another scheme that sort of contains all the previous one as special cases. Instead of having representative states, I have representative subsets. So an aggregate state one is associated with a subset of states. Aggregate state two is associated with another subset of states. I have all these subsets. However, the subsets may involve more than one state, and they need not cover the entire space. To give you an example, with aggregate state X, I may associate a group of states that has similar features. But some states that are not clearly identified with any one of the set of features that define this sets are sort of left outside of the aggregate states. So in this scheme, I start out with some aggregate state. I randomize within here, obtain the transition probabilities to go to other states, and then from there, I go to aggregate states according to the feed probabilities. There are some restrictions with this scheme. The aggregate states, the subsets should be disjoint. The disaggregation probabilities are positive only within here, but zero outside. And the aggregation probabilities within here are equal to one. So if you end up with a state J in here, you stay in here. Hard aggregation is the special case where these sets cover the entire space. Aggregation with representative states is a special case where these aggregate states consist of a single element. So it's a more general scheme and quite generally applicable. Any questions so far about how we formulate these aggregate problems and the different types of aggregations that we can use? Okay, so now assume that we have formulated an aggregate problem. We can try to do value iteration, policy iteration, or approximate versions of those. Let's focus on approximate policy iteration. We define, at a typical iteration, we have a policy that maps states X into controls, and we solve the corresponding aggregation equation associated with that policy. This is this equation here. R is a fixed point of this equation here. D is the matrix like this. T mu is the mapping that is high dimensional. Phi is the matrix, this aggregation matrix. And R is the vector of cost of the aggregate states for mu. And then we evaluate the policy according to this equation. And this can be done by simulation. If you can do simulation of the original system, you can also do simulation of the aggregate system. You just use the aggregation probabilities to go up this way, use the simulator of the original system to go to J, and then use the aggregation probabilities to go to Y. Back into I, across, down, and so on. The simulator is very easy to implement once you have a simulator of the original system. And there are simulation-based versions for solving this equation. And these equations actually are exact. We solve exactly this problem by simulation. There's no approximation involved. Now look at this equation here. It looks also like a projected equation. The projected equation has this form. So if phi r is equal to phi d t mu phi r, and phi d is a projection, then I also have a projected equation type of approximation. So it looks like the projected equation approach, but it has the advantage there's no problem with oscillations. Why is there no problem with oscillations? Because I'm applying policy iteration exactly with no approximations to this smaller problem. And I know that this converges in a finite number of steps. Relative to the projected equation approach, there's a disadvantage in that there's a restriction for phi and for d to be probability distributions. I cannot use arbitrary features. They have to be defined by probability distributions. And that is this is a significant restriction. So this is approximate policy iteration. There is also an approximate value iteration method associated with this, this aggregation. And it is exact value iteration for the approximate problem, followed by this feature-based weighting that gives you an approximation to the original problem. Now, there are some issues associated with this procedure, and there are too many for me to cover. What I'd like to do is cover them selectively in the last part of this lecture. So let's take a break now and come back and discuss these. Are there any questions? Yes?
Does aggregation help to avoid
Does it? Okay, so the question is, does aggregation help with the issue of exploration? And the answer is yes. It is much easier to implement exploration in a simulation-based context within this setting, because you simply choose a sampling scheme that involves exploration, adequate exploration of these states here. That's much easier to do. For example, they don't have to be generated by a single trajectory. They can be generated by just collecting a set of sample states, aggregate states, and using that in one-step transitions. This will work, and it will have absolutely no problem with exploration. So yes, it's not only easier to deal with oscillations within this context, but also exploration is an additional area where you get a benefit. But the disadvantage, of course, is that is this restriction. That's the problem. Okay, so let's take a break and get back in about 10 minutes.